לעילוי נשמת איוב בן
איוב
בן אלעזר. שלום עליכם everyone. There is a tradition in Jewish customs that we once a year make a yahrzeit to help the deceased people. It's called yahrzeit, azkara in Hebrew. Mentioning his name, making brachot on the food, making a meal, making ashkava, kaddish, everything is very important. But what's the most important thing for the soul of the person? What do you think helps him the most? So I tell you a story, you understand. Then I'll tell you the answer. But pay attention.
For him.
In this case, Baruch Hashem, I just met the sons of Ayub ben Elazar, so I just met them, so this is mainly for them, but it's for all of us. Tomorrow it's going to be us. Everybody has to do it one day. So there is in Israel, on the way to Yerushalayim, there is a place called Shoresh, Moshav, it's called Shoresh. They have country club. Over there you don't have religious people. It's for not religious people. It's on the way to Yerushalayim. But they make the place kosher. Why? Because they want religious people to come, to pass, stop by, to maybe play tennis, something. So if you don't bring kosher food, they're not going to come. So obviously they have a mashgiach. A mashgiach is a religious guy, and he's there all day, so he needs minyan. So he gets people from the next moshav, from the next town. Maybe some people work with him in a kitchen. So all together, they barely have 10 people. Every day a miracle. One time there are nine people, and they're waiting, it's becoming dark. Then they see somebody, Moshavnik, Kibbutznik, he doesn't know how to hold the Siddur even. He never pray in his life, nothing, walk by. Say, excuse me, can you do us a favor? You come maybe sit 15 minutes in the shul with us, we need 10 person. He's thinking, okay, I'll do you a favor. He went inside the shul, sat 1 minute. Why 1 minute? Because after they started Ashrei Yoshvei Betecha, somebody else showed up. So they told him, thank you very much, you can go. That's the story. 10 years later, this Mashgiach goes to sleep and he has a very important dream. He sees this Chaklai, this farmer from the Moshav. After 10 years, he saw him only 1 minute in his life. He comes to him in a dream and says to him, I'm so glad that I have permission to talk to you for 1 minute. He say, why, where are you? He say, I'm dead already. I'm not alive. But God gave me permission to speak to you exactly 1 minute. For the minute I was sitting inside the synagogue, and this is my son's name, and this is his telephone number. Call him, teach him to say Kaddish for me, teach him. He must say Kaddish for me every day. That was the dream. So he asked him quickly in a dream, why you came to me from all the people in the world? He said, because of that minute that you called me to come for the minyan, that was the only mitzvah I made in my life. For this mitzvah, Hashem agreed that I have permission to come ask you this favor. So that means, we see, this is one story. I have 100 stories like this. One time I went to Fairlawn, New Jersey, and I met husband and wife. They made in Israel, in Israeli Knesset, they started a party called Shinui. Shinui, it's anti-religion. They hate religion. They brought somebody from the television. His name is Tommy Lapid. He hates religion. He always speaks on television against the Torah. They brought him inside and they got 15 mandates. 600,000 people vote for them to go and destroy Judaism, the Torah. This happened only 10 years ago. Who started this? This husband and wife. After all these years, they left. They came to America for business. He was working for kitchen. They make kitchen in Israel, so he's the salesman here in America. He lives in Fairlawn. Somebody brought them into the lecture. They started to come a few times. They became religious. The woman comes to me and says, listen, when my father died, we were like goyim. We didn't sit even shiva, nothing. And also, one day my father went to Romania and disappeared. We never saw him ever again. And we were thinking, maybe he cheated on my mother and went with somebody to Romania and he doesn't care about us. So when he died, we hated him. We didn't care about him. Nothing we did for him. Only a few years later, they told us that he was an agent for the Mossad, for the Israeli Mossad. There was in the time, I think, of Ceausescu, he was communist in Romania, when they put him in jail and he died over there. Whatever they did to him, whoever goes to jail there never comes out. That's the story. So she said, what can I do now? Now I'm Shomer Shabbat. Can I do something? We don't have any brothers. It's only me and my sister. So I told her, take a little money every month. We have yeshiva in Monsi. You give it to one guy that say Kaddish every day. Give him whatever you can. And you nominate him. You give him money. He must do it. He cannot forget because it's a job. To say Kaddish for your father. You write his name and we give it to him. So she did that. She gave money with the name. I went to the yeshiva. I gave it to one of the guys in the yeshiva. I start to say Kaddish. A month and a half later, Friday morning, 11:30 in the morning, I'm on West Brapel Avenue in the light. I get a phone call. I see area code New Jersey. I pick up the phone. She's all crying on the phone, screaming, crying, excited. What happened? Don't ask what happened. My father came to me this night in a dream, half black, half white. He said, you're saving me, but don't stop. You're just saving me now. You started to save me, you're saving me. This is a woman that, if you knew who these people were in Israel, completely anti-religion, how much damage they make to so many Jews in Israel, now they shomer mitzvot. They even make lectures in the house in Fairlawn, New Jersey. Maybe they watch this lecture, they know who I'm talking about. This is just two examples. What happened to a soul after the person died? There's only one thing can help him, is his children. If his children love him and they do things for his memory, such as giving books to the synagogue, Gemara, tapes, DVDs for his memory, every mitzvah that other Jews do because of their money or their efforts goes automatically to help him and make his situation in the next world greater and greater. It's a famous Gemara that Rabbi Akiva saw a person, he saw an image of a person that is all depressed, holding woods on his back. So Rabbi Akiva ran to help him. Then he realized it's a spirit, it's not a person. So he said, oh, I see you're not alive. What is this? Why are you like this? So he said, I was very wicked. I never care about the Torah. And my punishment is like this. He said, well, you have a son? Don't you have a son that say Kaddish for you, make your tzeit for you? He said, no, my son is worse than a goy. I never taught him Hebrew, nothing. He said, give me the name. He gave him the name and the name of the town. Rabbi Akiva was the biggest rabbi in the world. Just imagine something like this happened. Rabbi Ovadia Yosef now goes to another town to look for the boy to teach him Aleph Bet. So important. Rabbis don't have time for Aleph Bet. You take a tutor, teach him Aleph Bet. Rabbi Akiva saw the situation of this man. He went, he came to the town, he told the people, I'm looking for this boy. He said, don't mention his name here, Rabbi. We don't want to hear this name here. No, I need to speak to him. He found the boy like a goy, drinking, not doing, you know, the worst you can think of. Slowly, he taught him Torah and how to say Kaddish. And after a while, the Gemara said, Rabbi Akiva saw him, he said, you saved me. This is the power of Kaddish. Why Kaddish is so important? It's very important, Kaddish for the soul. Kaddish is divided to four paragraphs. It's the secret of life inside the Kaddish. What's the life? What's life is all about? Some people think life here is to eat, to sleep, to play tennis, to go on vacation, and to drive a nice car. They don't understand that's not important in life. You have it, fine. You don't have it, also fine. That's not really a ticket to the life of eternity. The real purpose of life, as the Torah say, Hashem say, I'm putting you here in this material world to test you, to see what's in your heart. Do you love me and you keep my mitzvot or not? What for? What's this whole test about? To reward you in your end. La'ativcha be'acharitecha. When you finish, when I take your soul out of your body and you come to the world of eternity, over there there's no time, no limit. It's forever. Forever and ever. But what you get there is what you prepared here. You prepared good future, you're going to have good future. You didn't prepare, too bad, too late. So the situation, the Kaddish is like this. What do we have in this life? We have Hashem, God. We have the world. We have the human being, which is the most important creature in the world. And the purpose of life. Hashem, the world, the human being, and the purpose of life. That's the four categories. How Kaddish starts? Itgadal v'itkadash merabah. The name of Hashem should be praised and higher and elevated. So that's Hashem. First paragraph, it's God. Second, Be'alma Dibera, in the world that He created as He wished. Second paragraph is the world. What's the third one? B'chayechon uveyom echon uvchaydechol bet Israel. In the life of you and everyone else and the life of all the nation of Israel. So this is the human being. And what's the purpose of life? What we live for? For only one thing. Everybody scream, Amen, Yehe, Shmeh, Rabbah, Mevarach, to do Kiddush Hashem, to sanctify the name of Hashem. The Gemara say, She'itaev Shem Shamayim al Yadcha, that people see the way you behave, they are dying to be Jews, religious, not Chas V'Shalom, like some people give bad example today. They see the way you are, they see how honest you are, they say, you know what, I must be like you, this is the right way. People who make Kiddush Hashem, without even realizing, they make a lot of Jews around them better. People who misbehave, they make a lot of people worse, because the nature of the people is to copy others. If they see negative things, they become negative. If they see everybody righteous around them, they also become righteous. There are many examples like this. One rabbi, he had to take a bus from Tel Aviv to Netanya. Half an hour ride in a bus. When he got off the bus, he realized the driver gave him few coins extra by mistake. Jewish driver. Now, what can you do? Start looking for him for 50 cents, whatever it was. Guess what he did? He went to the other side and waited 2 hours until the bus went all the way and came back on the other side. You know, they have the routes all day. They go back and forth. After he came back, he comes and says, Oh, Baruch Hashem, I found you. You gave me extra 50 cents here. The driver says, you crazy? Hey, you're an old man like you. You were standing here all day in the heat just to give me this money? He says, I don't want to leave this world with 1 cent that it's not mine. It worth it for me to stand a week here, not to take this money with me. I'll never find you. So the driver says, you know what? Can I be in touch with you? Give me your telephone number. Where are you? I maybe come. I'll be in touch with you. Started to teach him Torah and made him religious. Why the driver wanted to be in touch with him? Because he never met a person like this in his life. And this is the obligation for every Jew to be like this. Few yeshiva guys went to the swimming pool in the vacation that they had. When they got there, they saw that the guard, he closed the gate, but you can jump over it. And he went and he came back after 20 minutes. So they were standing over there. Everybody else who came just went in. They went, they took their clothes off, jumped into the pool. Very good, we don't have to pay. But the 5-6 religious guy was standing there for a long time. And then when he finally came, he doesn't care. He works for the town. Let them go for free. He had to go somewhere. So when he came back, he said, well, we're waiting for you for a long time here. So why are you waiting for me? He said, because we couldn't go in. How are we going to go in? He said, what? Just go in, what? No. I can't go in, we have to pay. They also made him religious. This is a real story from life. When people see how you behave, they love the Torah. That's what the Torah says. I give you a few examples. David HaMelech was very rich, very handsome, very smart, very famous all over the world, the greatest soldier all over the world. Think about it. Try to imagine somebody like this generation, like David HaMelech, everybody bow down to him. And David HaMelech, every word in Tehillim is begging Hashem, help me to be close to you. Show me the way. Help me find the truth. Make me righteous. Help me. This is David HaMelech. Every word in Tehillim begging Hashem. What do you want? You have everything. You have a palace. You have messengers. You have servants. You have few wives. You have everything you need. Why do you worry so much? You have millions of dollars in your account. You're set for life. Your pension is forever. Why do you worry every second? The soul, when it's pure, it cannot live 1 minute without Hashem. That's what the Torah says. V'atem הדבקים בהשם אלוקיכם חיים כולכם היום. Those who are glued to me, like crazy glue, glue, you are alive. Which means what? If you're not glued to me, your life is not so great. Not what you think, oh, I have everything I need. Many places in the Torah, people don't pay attention. They read it a million times in their life, and I think one time they don't pay attention. What does it say? If you're going to listen to me and follow my mitzvot and my path, you will be alive. You would live. Leman tichye. In some places he say, you and your children after you would live. What do you mean would live? I'm alive without this. The Arabs on the street, they're not alive. The Jews that are not keeping any mitzvot, they're not alive. The dogs in the street are not alive. Everyone is alive. What do you mean? If you're going to keep my mitzvot and you follow my Torah, you would live. What do we understand? This is a divine book. It's not a newspaper. This is the creator of the world write that. Not somebody from the street. What does it mean? That if you don't follow my mitzvot, my Torah, and you live like a goy, you think you're alive, but you are dreaming. You can never be alive. When God say alive, means the soul, not the body. The body, you could have been a chimpanzee. He didn't need to make you a Jew with intelligence, speaking, reading. If life was just to eat and enjoy the material world, he'll make you a monkey. Doesn't need to make you a person with so much intelligence. Put you in a jungle, you enjoy the food, you have a wife, you have children, you have swimming pool, lake, you have everything. You don't need to work 30 years for the mortgage, problem, business, taxes, all traffic every day, 3 hours. That's it. It wouldn't make you this. It will make you very simple life. But we have a different purpose than the animals. What is the purpose? The soul. The soul. What's the soul? The divine soul. That has a free choice. No, so what's so great about free choice? You can do good, you can do bad. Every second you have full control on your life. You want to go to the synagogue, you want to go to learn Torah, you want to go to play. This is always a choice between positive and negative. And in the end, Hashem is going to take your file, he'll review your entire life. That's what the Torah says, Ayin Ro'ah, there's the eye who watch over you, Ozen Shomat, the ears who listens to you, וכל מעשיך בספר נכתבים. And every beep came out of your mouth and everything that you did in your life is registered in the book of God. What for? For good memories? That when you're done here, he's going to pull it out and will review every minute of everybody's life. Nobody can escape for the good and the bad that he did. Now, we have to know one thing. David HaMelech couldn't build the Beit HaMikdash. Since he was a soldier, he killed goyim. The goyim were the enemies of Israel. So it's a mitzvah to kill them. They come to destroy us. We have to destroy them first. Mitzvah. But God say, hands that spill blood cannot build Beit HaMikdash and the altar and all the important things. So David HaMelech say, I'm begging, at least let me make the foundation. Dig the hole. So Hashem said to Nathan, the prophet, go tell him that his son Shlomo will build Beit HaMikdash. So David HaMelech was very depressed, very upset, that he didn't have the zchut to build Beit HaMikdash. So, I just want to tell you what happened. King Solomon, his son, he built the Beit HaMikdash. The doors of the Beit HaMikdash, he couldn't open them, big doors. He said the name of all the tzaddikim, one generation after the other, the door doesn't open. Only when he mentioned the name of David HaMelech, the door opened. The zchut of David HaMelech, this whole Beit HaMikdash for the merit of his father, even though he built it. Now it's getting better. When Shlomo HaMelech made the Chanukat Bayit, the grand opening of Beit HaMikdash, that was the holiday of Sukkot. How many cows and sheep Shlomo HaMelech brought in the first day to Beit HaMikdash? Who knows? You're not going to believe it. Listen to this. 22,000 cows. Every cow today worth about $5,000. Let's calculate together how much money in the first day. Every cow, it's about $5,000, full cow. 22,000 times $5,000 is $110 million. Just the cows. How many goats and sheep? 120,000 goats and sheep is approximately $300 each today. If you go to the market to buy a goat, $300. How much? $36 million. How much together? $146 million in one day. Sacrifice animals for the opening of Beit HaMikdash. There's a lot of secrets in a sacrifice because it's all souls that are being reincarnated in animals. And once they've been slaughtered, it's repentance for all their sins in their previous life. But I don't want to go into it. It's already Kabbalah. Let's make it simple. After all this, Hashem see David HaMelech is upset. So Hashem came to David HaMelech and say, I want you to know. And this is what we have to learn. One day that you sit and learn Torah from morning to evening, worth for me more than all the sacrifices your son Shlomo will ever bring. This is the power of Torah. Your tzeit, you can eat and make a million brachot on the food. It's not worth like 1 minute of Torah. People don't understand the value of Torah. The Torah, it's the highest thing. If you sponsor Torah, nobody in Olam Haba can come close to you because every letter that the people say, thanks to your help, goes to your account. Million, another million, every hour, another million. The more people, the more mitzvot you do. You sit and eat lunch, you just made a million mitzvot. 15 minutes you ate a steak, you got up, you just made another million mitzvot. Another hour, 2 million. Another hour, 3 million. That's why the Satan is fighting against the yeshivot the most. No, we learn 2 hours a day, it's enough. Come on, Rabbi, that's okay, we don't have to be. We have to be doctors, we have to be engineers, that's more important. There was one rabbi in Hungary. Listen to this, it's really sweet like honey. This rabbi, when he was a kid, he had four brothers. His father sent them to yeshiva. There was a doctor in town that he sends his kids to modern school. They learn a little bit Torah, but most of the day they learn math, history, the rest. He sent his kids to college, the doctor. All his kids went to great university. This doctor always used to tell the rabbi's father, what are you wasting your children's life? You send them to yeshiva, it costs you money. What are they going to be? One day they'll be rabbis. No, what are they? They're never going to have enough money to live, no? It's not fair what you're doing to them. This rabbi, when he became a big Talmid Chacham, they put him a judge in a court, in a Beis Din. A judge. So he makes a decent salary, he makes a living. All his other brothers, also judges, Dayanim in Beit Din. Four, all of them in different Batei Din. This rabbi was well known in town that he helps all the people, all the miserable people, always come to eat in his house, he helps them, he sits with them. He helped them out, big mitzvah, to help miserable people. One time, he took a poor person in the middle of drasha, Thursday night, hundreds of people come to the synagogue to listen to his drasha. He took the poor person and made him sit next to him on the table, on the stage. Everybody in the crowd said, what are rabbis are doing today? He never took a poor person like this, dressed like this, and put him on a stage to embarrass him like this. Why does he do such a thing? Everybody couldn't listen because they were very curious to ask him why he put that poor man sitting on a stage. As soon as he finished to talk, they came to him, Rabbi, why you put that guy? He said, because I knew that right after the lecture, all of you going to run to me and ask me why I put him on a stage. That's why I put him on a stage. Okay, tell us the answer. He said, I wanted to make Kiddush Hashem. You know who is this son? Who is this guy? The son of that doctor. All his brothers are homeless in the streets, with their college and everything. Not that I want to embarrass him, but you know that that's not my intention. I wanted to teach all of you that money comes from Hashem, not from being a lawyer or a doctor or a businessman. If Hashem wants you, you'll be the dumbest person in the world. I met some like this here. Don't know 2 words in English and making millions of dollars. They don't know where from. They don't even know how much the accountant is stealing from them. They have so much. Why? Sometimes because you're dumb, you became rich. And that's not a lie. Sometimes because you're ugly, you became rich. I prove to you. One gabbai in a synagogue, he didn't know how to write. One day the rabbi passed away, they brought a different rabbi. The rabbi comes to him, "You the gabbai, nice to meet you. Where are the books of the synagogue? How much people give you and how much money you spend on a synagogue? I want to see what's going on here." He told him, "I don't have a book, I have a box. Whatever they give, I put in. Whatever we need, I take out, I pay. I don't have a record." No. That's not a market here. It's a shul. Somebody come and say, "What did you do with $1,000 I gave you?" You have to know what you did. "Why don't you have a book?" "I don't even know how to write. You want me to have a book?" "So okay, listen, we're going to pay you compensation, but we have to fire you." "We fire you." They fired him. They gave him X amount of money, and he doesn't know what to do with the money. He doesn't even know how to write. He can't find a job. He went to another rabbi. He said, "Rabbi, they fired me from the shul, but they gave me this $100,000. What do I do?" The rabbi said, "The way from the next town to here, it's few days of walking with a donkey." This story is more than 100 years ago. "So I want you to make a small motel with a restaurant right on the way. There's nobody thought about it. You make a lot of money, guarantee." So he went and built a motel. He made like 10 bedrooms for people to rent. He made them a restaurant, very good, and he's making money. And then he made the motel bigger and bigger and became a hotel. Now he's making fortune. One day, the manager in the bank is calling him. "Mr. X, can we have a meeting?" Yeah, he comes, they give him cigar, they move the chair for him. They come, they bring somebody to give him massage. He sits over there. He says, "Listen, we see you have millions of dollars here. Why don't you invest money with us in the bank? We buy real estate, developments. We can make you fortune on your money. Your money is yours, is laying in checking account." So he said, "Okay, makes sense. Let's do it. I make 15-20% extra every year. Why not?" So the manager of the bank begins to take all the contracts. He fills up the papers. After 20 minutes, he says, "Okay, please sign here, sign here." He goes like this with his finger. He takes a little box with ink. He goes like this. And he makes a fingerprint. So the manager says, "What is this?" "You have to sign. He has to go through the copies." He said, "I don't know how to write. I never hold a pencil in my life. I don't know how to write." He said, "You don't know how to write? How can it be?" He said, "Listen good. If I was smart, I wouldn't be here. You wouldn't give me massage and bring me cigars. The only reason I'm here because I'm dumb. Because I didn't know how to write, they fired me from the shul. I took the money and I made a hotel. If I was smart, I would be all my life a gabbai in a shul, going like this, give me some money for Shabbat." You understand? There's another story like this. There's a movie star in Israel that made millions of dollars from his movie. It's not Lashon Hara to mention his name because he brag about it on television. Whenever they ask him, he say, "I'm the ugliest person in Israel." He's very short. If you look at his face, you cannot believe. Very ugly. Why he became a millionaire? Because his face is so funny and ugly, right away they made him in comedy shows. They took him. All the comedy shows in Israel is there. And he made fortune. What happened if he would be handsome? Maybe he wouldn't have to pay his mortgage. When Hashem wants, he makes you what he wants. When he doesn't want, nothing will help you. Just before we finish, I'll tell you one more story. Rav Zinger in Hungary, he had a chocolate store. In the night, it's called Leil HaBdolach, the night that the Germans went and burned all the synagogues and all the Jewish stores. It was all over the Europe. It was in Czechoslovakia, in Hungary, in Russia, in Germany, everywhere. In Hungary, they had one street of Jewish kosher chocolate. All the Jewish stores in one street, like they have in Essex Street Jewish stores. Over here, the same story. They went and burned all the Jewish stores. Every place they saw mezuzah, they burned the place. In the morning, Rabbi Zinger, he's thinking, "Let me go to the store, see the damage, if there's anything to save." Comes to the place, he goes one store after the other, everything is burned. Smoke from all over. He comes to his store, completely brand new. Nobody touched it. How can it be? Well, it's too obvious of a miracle. Well, Hashem protect my store like this. He goes inside, He's the only chocolate store now in whole Hungary that still can sell kosher sugar, he sells a lot of things. Nobody, there's no competition. Hundreds of people come now this week to buy extra. All the people who used to go to the other store, they come to him. So his son comes and tells him, hey, Dad, why are you keeping the prices the same? Triple the price. They cannot get anywhere. We have no competition. Now it's the time to become very rich. His father told him, so what? Let's say I make more money. Can I enjoy money that came to me with the misery of my brothers and my sister? Other Jews are suffering and I want to become rich from their suffering? I'm not interested. Price is the same. 9:30 in the morning, a German soldier comes. He gets out of his car, you know, they come like this. Everybody got nervous, the Jews. He comes to him and he whispers to him in his ear, you know what? Why your store is still here and it's not burned? I was standing here all night, from last night, 10 o'clock, until the morning, and guard your store for you. Everybody who came to burn your store, I sent them away. You don't recognize me, huh? I used to be the delivery truck. I used to bring you sugar and cocoa. You don't remember me? He looks at him, he takes his hat off. Oh yeah, a few years ago you used to deliver me merchandise. He said, but I used to deliver merchandise to all the other stores here. Why did I only protect your stores? So the rabbi asked him why. He said, because every time I came, you came out to help me with the boxes. You were helping me, and when I went in, you made me tea, you gave me water, you treat me like a real human being. Everybody else didn't even say hello to me. I was talking to all the Jews here, they looked at me like a dog. I was very happy to see their stores go on fire. But when I heard that they're coming to burn the store, the first thing came to my mind is you. You don't deserve to have such a thing. First thing I did, I came here. Everyone that came, I said, this store, nobody can touch. And I protect your store. After he passed away, his son in Israel is also a big rabbi. He told the story. And he said, my father really believed that the only reason that the Goy protected his store is because he was nice, kind to him. So he felt that he's grateful to him. He has to do something for him. But that wasn't the reason. The reason is that from the minute I remember my father until the minute he died, he was the most honest person in the world. There was not even one reason for Hashem to take a penny away from him. When you lose money, you stole from someone. You took interest you're not supposed to. You cheat in a business. You cheat the customer. You were not so kind to other people. Whatever the case, there could be millions of reasons. Everything in life has a reason. This person was so clean, his hands were so clean, that Hashem said, what am I going to make him $200,000 damage for? He doesn't deserve to lose a penny. He sent that guy, the Nazi, standing with his cross, standing watching his store all night. This is what the Torah says. Birtzot Hashem darkei ish, gam oivav yashlim imo. When God is satisfied from you, He brings your enemies to be your servant, to make peace with you. Why? Because he is the one who controls everything. If He's satisfied from you, who can touch you? Nobody can touch you. This is what the Torah says. Rotze Hashem et kol oavav ve'et kol amyachalim lechasdo. Hashem said to the Jews, you want me to help you? I'll be happy. But I love to help Jews that are thinking every day, how today I'm going to help them. If the Jews walk in the street, Hashem, how are you going to help me today? How are you going to bring my bread to the table today? How are you going to help me with my son? How are you going to help me with my wife? How are you going to help me with my problem, with my health, with the doctor, with the surgery? If a person is always opening his mouth for the rain goes in. But if he doesn't care, so it's all nature. Sometimes you up, sometimes you down. And Bezrat Hashem, like I said, we say this Divrei Torah, we also film it. We're going to put it on the website. There's going to be a lot more people who watch. It's going to be only all for the zchut of the Niftar. It brings him a lot of joy and happiness. Why? The power of Torah. And after that, we're going to say Kaddish, prepare the Kaddish. It's Bezrat Hashem, a good help. We'll finish with two more minutes, and then I know I made it a little long, but I wanted it to be a lecture, not just a little talk. So Rav Galinsky, I once went with him on a plane. He was very short rabbi. Short but giant. Everybody knew Rabbi Galinsky. When he used to talk, it's like electric in the air. That's how big he was. So he was in Siberia. The Russians used to send the Jews to Siberia for every little thing. Siberia, wow. No shoes, walking in the snow, 30 below zero. Horrible life over there. One of the punishments they used to give them in a camp is 40 days without food. We don't eat one day Yom Kippur. By the end of Yom Kippur, we faint. Maybe they give them a little water, but 40 days, no food. Rabbi Galinsky, when he was in his 20s, they put him in an isolation, 40 days, no food. After 40 days, they brought him a lousy soup with some carrots and potatoes. This is the meal. After 40 days, didn't eat. Just when he was about to attack the plate, he saw another Jew that is in the same situation, in the same jail, 20-something days without food. He didn't finish his 40. He looked around, nobody is watching. He said, how can I eat the soup when another Jew is dying next to me? He came to him and said, let's split it half and half. Bring something, a bucket. He gave him half of the soup. That was the story. Years later, he came out of there and he went to Israel. When he was finally already a Talmid Chacham, the Chazon Ish told him one day, I need you to do me a favor. What's the favor? They just brought all the Sephardic Jews and the Zionists. They put them in the Ma'abarot. Ma'abarot was a camp in Israel that they made them some houses, temporary houses. And they're about to send them to kibbutz. Once these kids go to the kibbutz, they become goyim, finish. They don't know Torah, Shabbat, kosher, nothing over there. I know a lot of these Sephardic people are very good and naive. They don't know. They can take advantage on them and send them to the kibbutz. We have to save their children. I want you and this rabbi to go inside, make a list of all the families that agree that we take their children and we send them to yeshiva, and one day when they come out of the camp, we'll bring them back their children. We'll take care of them. We have an orphan house. We're going to put them over there. Make me a list. He comes to the camp. He sees it's all fence around it. There's guards. Cannot go in. They took shovel. They made a hole under the fence. Very big, deep hole. The two rabbis, they went inside. And now they're walking around like thieves. After an hour or two, they're trying to find out who is the father, who has kids, how many, and to try the right names. One guard came, called them, started to speak to them in Yiddish. They were trying to pretend they don't understand Yiddish, but he saw their beads. He caught them right away. By the time they're thinking what to do with them, he looks around. Who does he see? The Jew that he gave him half of the plate of the soup 30, 40 years before. He looks at him, says, don't you remember me? He looks at him, how can I forget you? Years I'm thinking about you, I'm alive thanks to you. He says, I need a big favor. What's the favor? You are here, he's one of the counselors over there. I want you to do it for me because they're not letting me. Make a list of all the Sfaradish family here that are willing to send their children, right? Name of the family, how many children? We come with a truck, we pick them up. He said, wow, you're going to get me into a lot of trouble. If they know that I'm doing it, it's a very big problem. He said, you owe me big time. I do not want anything for myself. For these children, you help me to save them. 65 Sephardish families send all their kids to yeshiva and save them. Who knows what would happen to them? So what do you see from this story? When he decided to give half of his soup to another Jew, what is it? It's a big thing, but how much is this? $1? $2? What was it? After all, fine. Thanks to this, Hashem gave him, in his life, an opportunity to save, who knows, 200-300 kids. Every words of Torah they learn go to his account. Their children goes to his account. By now, their grandchildren goes to his account. For what? For $2 he gave with all his heart. This is called chesed, real chesed. When the chesed is real, Hashem says, I'm crazy about your mitzvah. I gotta do something for you. That's called mitzvah, goreret mitzvah. Hashem love your mitzvah, right away push into it another one. One leads to another. Chas v'shalom, it could be the other way around. Avera goreret avera. בעזרת השם, I hope that my words will help the niftar Yov ben Elazar to give him nachat ruach, נשמתו בגן עדן, וכן יהי רצון ונאמר אמן. רבי חנניה בן הקשיא אומר, רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות ישראל, לפיכך הרבה להם תורה ומצוות, שנאמר, אדוני חפץ למען צדקו יגדיל, תורה ויאדיר.